So now that we know what a solid solution is and we understand this phase diagram of albite and anorthite, what we are going to do is we are going to understand the melting and crystallization behavior within this solid solution system. So to start with, first I will try to understand the melting behavior. So now let's imagine if you have an original plagioclase which has a composition of 60% weight anorthite, so somewhere here. So this composition, let's say, lies somewhere over here. This is what we call as the bulk composition of my system. So the, all the liquid that we have, if I take it as one big chunk, it has a composition which is 60% anorthite. Now what I'm going to do here is I'm going to cool my liquid, and as I cool it, as you expect, at some point of time it will start to crystallize. But what we see here, what we will see in this system, is that crystallization behavior is slightly different from a one component system. So before we start all that, we'll just get a few things out of our way. So the first one is the number of degrees of freedom in different zones. So I'm starting in this zone over here, which is my starting point. It's a liquid zone. So in this zone, my number of phases phi equals just one, which is my liquid. This is the liquid or the melt. Another thing, throughout this diagram we see number of components is always going to remain 2. So you have albite and anorthite. If you remember, albite we defined by NaAlSi3OA and anorthite as CaAl2Si2O8. So these two end members, the whole system, we can define it by different number of components. Component is something which we are choosing. We can define this whole system by other components, for example, as oxides, which are Na2O, CaO, Al2O3, SiO. But as we learned, that number of components is the minimum number of chemical constituents that you need to define all the phases. So we don't need all these four. So what we can do here is we can combine some of them. As for example, we can take one group, which is this. Another group we can take is Al2O3 plus Na2. So we need only two components here. The minimum number is two that we need to define all the phases. So C in this zone and C everywhere in this diagram is going to be 2. Another thing I told about this phase diagram is pressure is fixed. So as you remember, for if pressure is fixed, we use the phase rule, F equals C minus phi plus 1. So it becomes here is 2 minus 1 plus 1 equals 2. So degrees of freedom within this zone, where you have only liquid, you have F in this zone is equals to. What do you mean by 2 degrees of freedom? So 2 degrees mean you need at least to define this system, you need minimum of 2 intensive variables. And what are those 2 intensive variables? You need to define both temperature and composition within this region. So if you are within this liquid region, so you need to define both temperature and comp, because I can be here or I can be here or I can be here. All these 3 points have different temperature and composition values. Now let's say I start to cool my system. So if I cool it, its temperature is going to decrease, but my composition, overall composition, will remain fixed. So what I'll get is, because my x value is fixed and my y value is continuously decreasing, which is temperature, so I'll get a straight line here until at this point I hit my liquidus curve. So at this liquidus curve, at this point, exact point, there are now 2 phases. So I already have a liquid phase and the plagioclase is also starting to crystallize. Now this liquidus why do we call it liquid acid? Is this, it is going to give us the composition of the liquid, and the solidus curve is going to give us the composition of the solid. So at this point, my bulk composition is still 60% anorthite. The interesting thing over here is the first crystal that I start to form. So just imagine, if this is your magma chamber, which is filled with plagioclase rich fluid, and the very first crystal that forms. So let's say this is my first crystal. It will not have a composition which is the same as the melt. Instead, it is going to have a composition which is slightly richer in the anorthite component. And whenever on this curve, you have to get the composition. So how you get it is you draw a horizontal line passing from your bulk composition. So this horizontal line, where it intersects the solidus curve, that is going to provide me the composition of my solid. So if you look here, the composition of this solid over here, it is almost 90% anorthite. So you're starting with a liquid which is 60% anorthite, and now you are getting a first solid crystal which is 90% anorthite. So this is your first solid. Now what we do is we keep on continuing our cooling process. So it cools to another temperature. So at this lower temperature, what is going to happen? So now you have a solid at this point near the solidus, and you have a liquid. So you have a liquid here and you have a solid here. So this liquid and solid, they are both in equilibrium with one another. So this is very important condition, your equilibrium condition, which means that your solid and liquid, they can coexist and they can react with one another to form the other, and the process is reversible. But if one of the solids, or let's say the liquid, is removed by some other process, for example fractional crystallization or fractional melting, then it is no longer available to react with other component, and what we have in this case is sort of a non-equilibrium condition.